Welcome, and we're glad that you joined us. Jump in the car. Let's go. It's time for Two Lane Tales with the 66 Kids, and it's brought to you by the True Ranch Collection and the Tombstone Monument Ranch. So let's put it in high gear, and let's go.
Russell True, it's great to have you. I did not realize that you are related to one of the most proficient and famous artists in the West, and I'm embarrassed because I'm a huge fan of Russell and Remington and Talos 7 and everyone else. Who was this relative of yours?
So I'm sort of named after him by extension. My father was Alan Russell True. The artist was Alan T. True, Alan Tupper True, and I'm Alan Russell True, Jr. And so he is was my great uncle. Never met him. He died before I was born. And he was a prominent artist and muralist, did easel work, did three state capitals, designed the Wyoming iconic, I think only trademarked license plate in the U.S., bucking horse. And has murals all over Denver and Colorado in general. Grew up in Colorado Springs area and went to Europe and London and then was trained by Howard Pyle, a famous illustrator in Vermont, where he met N.C. Wyeth and they became fast friends.
Wow, that is incredible. And what are the state capitals that he has the murals in?
So he started out, he was working under a famous Welsh muralist named Brangwyn, who got the commission to do the Missouri Capitol. And so with his level of reputation, he was able to bring along a helper, Alan T. True, who did a lot of the work. And then Missouri was so pleased with Alan's actual work under Brangwyn that they commissioned him to do some more on his own. And so he has both what he did for Brangwyn and under his own name in the Missouri Capitol, which led to Wyoming and Colorado capitals where his murals are today.
Wow. And then the iconic Wyoming license plate, I mean, that has to be one of the signature pieces in the entire West. Everyone recognizes that at 100 yards. I mean, that is truly amazing. How did that happen?
So he got he knew a lot of people. And he was, I guess you would say, socially prominent in the culture of the West. And he knew, I can't think of his first name, but the Secretary of State Hunt in Wyoming commissioned him for $75 to design the Wyoming license plate. And Hunt later became the governor of Wyoming. And, you know, there was all these stories that it was midnight you know, the famous bucking horse. And he said, no, there was no human or horse model. It was just my artistic imagination.
Wow. And it's so strong. And what cracks me up, being an artist myself, is the $75 fee. That never changes. You know, I was approached in Kingman. I was a commercial art at the University of Arizona, and they said, we had a logo contest for Mojave County, and a young Indian person did the thing, and we need a commercial artist to clean it up. And I said, great, what would you pay? And he said, $75. So I think it's a standard fee down through the ages. Not that my Mojave County Museum logo is on the level of Alan True. That is absolutely amazing. And if you want to see some of these paintings, they're throughout the White Stallion guest ranch and in the lobby and then in the kitchen, correct?
Yeah, no, they're throughout the dining rooms, all three dining rooms. And it's just funny how sometimes you're blind to your own reality, we were redoing all our dining rooms at White Stallion, and we were looking at this art and that art, and my wife Laura said, "Russell, isn't your great uncle kind of a famous artist, and don't we have some of his art in the house?" And I thought, "Oh my gosh, I wasn't really fully engaged mentally there." So we went to our cousins and Hank and David and Deemer, they all contributed some digital reproductions, and Diana Medeiros, who's a highly respected artist in Tucson, helped us both in terms of the creation of the reproductions at a very, very high level. I have to say the reproductions look better than my nearly 100-year-old originals in the house. So they were able to bring the color back and helped us place them and size them. And they really are a great feature. And we just love that history. And then we went to the Smithsonian and elsewhere, and there was really a beautiful coffee table book done by Alan's daughter and granddaughter. And we were able to find, black and whites, just some that told the story of his life. And we put those down the hallway. So if people are interested, they can learn a little bit about him.
Hey, Alan, this is Stuart Rosebrook. I was, sitting at breakfast this morning admiring one of his paintings of a stagecoach, and it really reminded me of Olaf Weekhorst and some of the artists of that era. And tell us a little bit more about where Alan lived, where his career, did he move around the West? Was he settled in Wyoming or Colorado? You said Colorado Springs. And was his art featured in, there's another black and white across from it of a stagecoach. Was he featured in a lot of novels or in like Liberty Magazine or Look or Collier's? And his artwork just comes right off the canvas.
Yeah, I love it. You know, it's funny. My mom always said, "I think it's a bit dark." And one of the things that my mom was a harsh critic, and she goes, "Well, it's a little dark." You know, one of his quotes was, he wasn't a huge fan of some of the work of the two most famous, Remington and Russell, because he felt that it showed less the reality and more the drama. Well, both are real, so I'm not sure. And some of his paintings show some pretty brutal wrecks and some of the more Russell and Remington-esque type stuff. So back to your question. His father had the biggest string of mules doing livery freight work out of Colorado Springs. It was about 1,600 mules. And of course, as the technology of the time, meaning railroads, changed that went away, and they did some other things. They had a grocery store and different things. So, Henry True was his father, and Henry True goes all the way back to 1600s England when they migrated to the U.S. But so he started out there and went, and I don't know the technical. There's a PBS story that tells a brilliant, really a great job of telling his story. But he went to London, Europe, did some training. He ended up with Howard Pyle, who was a famous illustrator in Vermont, which is where he met N.C. Wyeth. And told N.C. Wyeth that he had to go out west. And so Wyeth went and stayed with Alan's parents in the Colorado Springs area and began. And if you look at his history of work, there's a period where he's painting the West.
Yes.
And Alan, according to the book, said, "Oh, my God, he's painting the West. I better get back there."
Because he's really good. N.C. Wyeth and Howard Pyle were doing all those big Scribner books.
Yeah.
And so Alan's work appears in books as an illustrator, Outdoor Magazine, and a lot of illustrating. And then he got into the murals, did a lot of easel work, and also did some sculptures.
This has been fantastic, and what a find. I thought I knew. I've been to NCY's studio, and I'm very much a fan of all those guys. But to discover a new talent like this is just incredible. And to think that you're related to him.
Yeah, none of that. The genetic study there fails.
No, you're very creative in your own way. This has been fantastic. Great talking to you.
Well, he's also, I remember in True West magazine, I think it was a cover story, is Maynard Dixon. What was the question? Is he one of the greatest Western artists, or was he the? And yes. They were friends. And
yeah, and you know what? You said was very interesting to me, which is at the time, and I'm talking about in the 20s and 30s, as the West began to rise as a theme, Maynard Dixon left New York because he was so upset with the art directors who wanted him to portray the violent West, and he felt like what they wanted was not real, and he wanted to go paint the real. So he rejected that and left. So he has a lot in common with Alan Day.
So did Alan live? Did your uncle, great uncle Alan, did he live out his life in Colorado Springs? And obviously he was a working cowboy with his father and knew his way around the back of a horse and cattle. Where did he live out his life as an artist?
In that area. There, in fact, somebody bought his house studio, and they restored it. And if you ask him, at least this was a few years ago, true, they'll give you a tour and you can see where he was. And I don't remember exactly where it is, but it's in that area. And he did live out there, and he got divorced, and it was a real heartbreaking divorce for him, I'm told, and had kids and grandkids. And there's great photography of him with the kids, and both as a guy with woolly chaps and out in the wilderness. He and his wife went out for their honeymoon in a Model T and camped. And so there's great photography of him as a painter artist who could be in New York, or a guy who could be the ranch hand out on the range. So he lived both lives, met all kinds of people, including Franklin Roosevelt, and was friends with people whose names we know and are more famous than he ended up.
Well, I think that his legacy is something that more and more people need to know. He really is one of the giants of the craft in the first half of the 20th century. And I think that this is a real two-lane tale of the West. And one of the things that I think that we hope on Two-Lane Tales, we bring these stories to you each week. Stories that people don't know about or need to know about our great West, and that they can come down here to the White Stallion and learn more about one of the West's greatest artists, Alan True.
Thank you, Alan. I'm Alan.
Well, thank
you, Russell. I was so into that. That was so great.
Well, thank you very much. That's a wrap. And yes, Bob, we were really into it. What a fascinating story about those Wyoming license plates and all of the stories about a great Western artist. And as it was mentioned, you'll see some of those at the White Stallion Ranch, where oftentimes this program originates from. Now, that is just one of the ranches which are a part of what are known as the True Ranch Collection. And it's a selection of historic dude ranches that are offering guests an authentic Western experience, as well as a taste of the adventure of being a cowboy. The True Ranch Collection aims to preserve the historic tradition of dude ranching, from its celebration of Western heritage to its history as an early destination vacation in the United States. Yes, it is all of that, but it's also a place for you and your family right now. So why don't you say, this time we're going to do things differently. Let's go out to the ranch. Let's go back to the ranch. Maybe let's go to the ranch for the first time. And the True Ranch Collection folks, those cowboys and cowgirls, they'll find a good place for you. So go to TrueRanchCollection.com. That's TrueRanchCollection.com. Or why don't you talk to one of them? 520-365-0305. Once again, 520-365-0305. Well, that's it for this week, folks, but we hope you'll join us again on Route 66, Two Lane Tales. Till next time, bye for now.